good morning. You are such an electrifying group. The power keeps blowing this morning, which is why we're starting just a couple of minutes late. Actually, we have hot food because they plugged it into the same unit that the hot videos are on. So is there anybody in the room that could help with this power thing? PGE? No, I'm teasing. Welcome. Welcome to the Gresham Mayor Chamber of Commerce 2015 Economic Summit. We've gathered an impressive team of speakers for you this morning, and I know you're not going to be disappointed. The theme for this morning is reaching our potential. Other ways that we could say it, if you look at what reaching means and you look at what potential means, is realization of our abilities, stretching a promise, accomplishing the conceivable, attaining the imaginable. There are different ways of saying the same thing, and there's different ways of doing it to get it accomplished. Reaching our potential. Each speaker today has been asked to focus their comments on the who, what, where, when, and or why we should reach our potential. Reaching our potential is more than a theme. It's a dream, and it's not the kind of dream that you just have and then forget. It's the kind of dream that you want to achieve. We can and will reach our potential. And it starts today, this morning, at Persimmon, with you. Before our speakers join us on stage, I want to acknowledge, as is traditional and very important, solid and generous leaders that are in this room, in the audience. Now, I could have all of you stand up because you're all solid and you're all genuine leaders. But there's some particular ones that I want to acknowledge. And the first ones start with incredible men and women that serve the chamber. Over half of the entire chamber board is here this morning. That's a quorum, but we're not voting on anything, ladies and gentlemen. Would you please stand? Would all of my chamber board members please stand right now so that we can acknowledge you? Please stand. Follow directions. That's right. Thank you so much. Josh, Matt, Scott, Andrew, John, Sue, Deborah, Lori, Julie, Jim. Thank you, Scott. I thought maybe something happened while I was gone and three new board members came. You know, more things have happened that. All right, so the next thing that is traditional and very important is to thank our sponsors. We all know that mornings like this, days like this, events like this don't happen without the financial support. But as is my tradition, I would like you to hold your applause because I don't want this to be an applause-o-meter contest. If you'd hold your applause until I have announced all of the sponsors, and then we'll give a round of applause, a huge round of applause for every one of them. So I want to start today by thanking Boeing as the presenting sponsor. Deanna Haley, thank you so much for what you've done to get Boeing here. Don't applause. There's a couple people over here, a little anxious, overachievers. The next is the keynote sponsor, and that would be PGE. John Maloney is responsible for that. John, thank you so much. PGE, thank you. Frontier is our breakfast sponsor. You're eating because of Frontier. That's not a normal thing. You're usually viewing because of Frontier. Thank you, Frontier and Jason. Our networking sponsor, Mount Hood Legacy Hospital, and Julie, a board member, is responsible for that sponsorship. Thank you. Workforce sponsor, who else but Mount Hood Community College, and Dr. Durr is responsible for that. Our speaker sponsors, the rest of the speakers, not just the keynote, is the Port of Portland. Keith Lovett, you'll hear from him in a few minutes. Thank you, Keith. Economic development sponsor, the City of Gresham, of course. Economic development that goes hand in hand, Mayor Bemis, thank you for that. Our healthcare sponsor, Adventist Health. If you have a problem, Adventist will help you today because they're the healthcare sponsor, right? Is that how that goes? Maybe not. Okay. But Doreen Brower, thank you for helping us with that. Our supporting sponsors, Access Design Group. Tim, I didn't see Tim come in this morning. Is he here yet? There he is. Hi, Tim. Thanks for being here today. Tim Bruner and Gresham Sanitary. Matt? All right, thank you very much, Matt. Our table sponsors, Gresham Barlow School District, M Bank, Warren Allen, Weston Buick, GMC, and Kia. Jim, thank you very much from the school district. Casey from M Bank, thank you. Warner is in court today, suing the socks off of somebody. And Josh with Weston. Did I say that out loud? I'm in trouble now. And our media sponsor, MetroEast. Thank you. Now, a round of applause for all of them. Bigger, bigger. Thank you. We have some elected officials in our office, in our audience as well. Is Grace Neal here this morning? I've never met Grace. She hasn't attended yet. Grace is coming on behalf of U.S. Senator Ron Wyden. When she gets here, I hope I get a chance to introduce you to her. We have State Senator Lori Moniz Anderson with us. Senator Anderson, thank you. You can applaud her if that's okay. I would get in trouble if that didn't happen. And last minute, State Senator Chuck Thomas said, Thompson said that he sends his regrets from his home in Hood River. State Representative Carla Peluso is here. She was part of the photo op there. Thank you, Representative. Metro Councilor Shirley Craddock. I saw Shirley, but I'm not sure where she landed. There she is. Hi, Shirley. Thank you so much. We are going to hear from him soon, but Mayor of Gresham, Mayor Shane Bemis, is with us this morning. Mayor, stand. Thank you. And perhaps the newest mayor in the world, because it's the newest city in the world, maybe not the world, but Oregon, we have Mayor from Damascus, Diana Helm. Diana, thank you for being with us. And we also have Gresham City Councilors, Carolyn Eccles. Carolyn, thank you. Kirk French, thank you, Kirk, and Lori Stegman, thank you. All right, we have a little housekeeping. If anybody has a cell phone and it rings, that's $100 to the Chamber Fund. You think I'm kidding? I'm all about money, raising money for the Chamber and for the community, so take care of that. The other housekeeping issue is you have on your tables in groups the evaluation forms. If you'd like to take one and jot down notes, these really help make these events get better and better over the years, so we'd appreciate it if you would take care of that as well. And then we'll pick them up at the end of the morning. Good morning. Are you Grace by any chance? Oh, good. Grace, from U.S. Senator Ron Wyden's office. Grace Neal. Thank you. Great entrance. You know, Senator Wyden's taught you well. All right. I am so thrilled that Mayor Bemis delayed his flight to Baltimore to attend. He's going there to attend the U.S. Conference of Mayors leadership meeting in order to be with us this morning. Now, I'm supposed to say something funny about the mayor right now, about him leaving this event early, kind of like the Ducks left the game early on Saturday. But I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to say it. Okay, Mayor Bemis was sworn into office. By the way, he is the only Duck rooter that will be presenting this morning, so we've got that balance going. No, no. Mayor Bemis was first sworn in as mayor, the 26th mayor of Gresham, in 2007. He lost no time focusing and implementing programs around his passions, economic development, business, and community safety. Mayors and city managers from all over the country have called about our Garage to Storefront program. We're very proud of that and well known for it. It ushered 144 new small businesses into the previously vacant storefronts. Thousands of taxpayer dollars have been saved for his energy-efficient and money-saving upgrade to the LED streetlight bulbs. That may not seem like a big deal, but I appreciate when government saves my tax money. A strong supporter of sustainable practices, Shane serves as the chair of the Energy Committee for the United States Conference of Mayors. There's a lot of mayors to choose from. That's a pretty high clout of a position. He has spoken nationally about Gresham's sustainability and energy-efficient initiatives. And in his spare time, he's a restaurant owner and has been for 15 years. Mayor Bemis was the architect of the city's push to clean up MAX, assigning uniform officers to patrol the trains, and the program was credited for increased safety on light rail. His advocacy also sparked the creation of a dedicated TriMet law enforcement precinct housed in the Gresham Police Department. In his State of the City address this last spring, Mayor Bemis, the father of three boys, was quoted as saying, "Be all in, giving kids every chance that we can." That is his attitude about Gresham as well. He is all in, and he wants us to be all in too, giving Gresham every chance we can to reach our potential. Please welcome to the stage the Honorable Mayor Shane Bemis.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for the opportunity to be here with you all today. This is always one of my favorite events because it reminds me collectively of how much human capital we have in Gresham and how we need to harness that to move this community forward. So many people for so many years have given so much to this community and continue to do so, and it is always an honor to be with you in those endeavors. One of those people, as you know, is the Chamber's new Executive Director, Lynn Snodgrass, and she's wasted no time at all, as you can imagine, at getting the City and the Chamber collaborating together on our shared goals. So I want to thank you, Lynn, wherever you went. I didn't see. There you are. I want to thank you, Lynn, for your leadership and your tenacity, and also the pumpkins, because I know that wouldn't have happened without you, these nice pumpkins, Drake 70s. We've got it. So Lynn asked me to start the day off by unleashing the secret about Gresham and the myriad of ways that the city and chamber and the business community work together to promote economic vitality in our community. The irony in us unleashing the secret about Gresham in this venue is that all of us in this room work tremendously hard to make sure that our open for business climate and economic development efforts are no secret to anybody. My hope for today is that I can pass along a few key pieces of information that will help you when you are sharing East County's economic development story with those in your various networks. To start things off, I'd like to update you on a few of the recent expansions we've seen from some of our key industrial companies. This year, we have 7 industrial expansions from our traded sector companies, including construction that is currently underway at Seco Logistics to add an additional 23,000 square feet to their distribution logistics operation, and also Teeny Foods, shown here, who is currently expanding by 80,000 square feet, nearly tripling their current footprint. The city's economic development staff support our existing businesses, including these expansions, through our dedicated permitting assistance, our connection to workforce resources, and our export assistance. Altogether, existing Gresham companies have added or are currently adding nearly 500,000 square feet to their operations since last December. Of course, this is great news for the city as these successful companies continue to invest in their businesses here in our community. One of the areas in which Gresham has been particularly aggressive, more aggressive than any of our counterparts in the region, is in trying to make sure that we are doing everything humanly possible to help businesses get from their first permit to their ribbon cutting in as short of time as possible. This effort has resulted in an expedited industrial review timeline, guaranteeing our major traded sector industrial applicants that we can complete all of the necessary reviews in 66 days or fewer. And the City Council codified that. State law gives you 120 days. We said we're going to put our money where our mouth is. We codified it and said we will do it in 66 days, the first city of anywhere in the state. That puts Gresham at the front of the pack when it comes to expediency in our region, and it gives us a competitive edge moving forward. The first project done under this new timeline was completed by the McKenzie Group, who afterwards sent the city a letter which said, in part, "If our experience is any indication, Gresham should be very competitive in the future industrial development projects." Also, on the topic of our industrial improvement efforts, the Daily Journal of Commerce said, "Industrial development in Gresham has taken off, and it's no coincidence that the city has focused the last few years on breaking down barriers to make that happen." This short timeline and the city's commitment to industrial development with our other tools like the Enterprise Zone, new industry grants, and rapid response team approach have together helped attract 11 new businesses to the community this year. Together, these new industrial companies will fill nearly 650,000 square feet of industrial space in Gresham. This past July, our expedited industrial review timeline was an important piece of the puzzle that enabled the city and our partners at the Port of Portland to announce one of the biggest wins we have seen in years. The Subaru of America will be developing 600,000 square feet distribution center on Gresham Vista Business Park. 600,000 square feet in Gresham Vista Business Park. That's exciting. The master distribution center will sit on 40 acres, allowing for expansion up to another 235,000 square feet in the future. This project will bring an estimated $50 million in investment into this community. As you likely know, the Port of Portland purchased the 221-acre Gresham Vista property shown here from LSI in 2011. In the years since, the city and the port have built an incredible partnership to attract investment there, including receiving state certification that the land is shovel-ready, and we are actively marketing the land to developers, brokers, site selectors, and individual companies. Leading this Subaru development, which broke ground last week, is a landing the Subaru development, which broke ground last week, is a huge step for Gresham Vista, and I'm confident that our joint efforts there will continue to pay off with additional development and investment in the months and years to come. We put substantial effort into recruiting traded sector employers because a single entity could bring investment in the hundreds of millions and jobs in the thousands. But that does not mean we lose focus on the smaller scale businesses as well. As you likely know, and as Lynn mentioned in her introduction, we had a great first run with the city's Garage to Storefront program. It had 144 new or expanding businesses fill over 250,000 square feet of previously vacant commercial space, invigorating key areas of Gresham and giving our entrepreneurs the nudge they needed to help lead us out of that recession. The original Garage to Storefront program ran for 3 years. It eventually sunsetted in December of 2012 as a product of its own success and the gradually improving economy. I'm pleased to share with you today that as of July, the Garage to Storefront program is back in Gresham. Although the need is certainly not as dire as it was during the height of the Great Recession in 2010 when we first instituted the program, we reinstated the simple but powerful fee holiday to continue filling empty or underperforming storefronts with new retail activity. Like the original Garage to Storefront 2.0, waived city fees and charges for qualifying businesses in Gresham's key commercial districts, Central Rockwood neighborhood, Civic neighborhood, and historic downtown Gresham. While that is the jumping off point, version 2.0 is better than the first iteration in that it offers both incentives for new and expanding commercial businesses and new incentives aimed at helping property owners make storefront improvements and get their spaces lease ready. Now, if you're a qualifying property owner, now is a tremendous time to be investing in your building. For new or expanding businesses filling no more than 5,000 square feet of currently vacant commercial space, this means the city will waive business license fees, commercial tenant improvement permit fees, and system development charges. For qualifying property owners in these same incentive zones, the city is offering zero city-related permits to remodel existing vacant commercial space and or facade improvements for vacant or occupied commercial space as well. With the uptick in the economy, we're on track this year to issue more business licenses than any year since the recession. We have already had a few businesses take advantage of the reinstated Garage to Storefront incentives, and I'm confident that we will see that trend continue as we move forward. We're seeing some encouraging trends in residential development in Gresham as well. Not only are we hearing anecdotally that the demand for housing is on the rise, our data reflects that growth as well. This slide shows the total valuation of new residential property for which the city has issued permits for the last 5 years. As you can see, since 2010, that total valuation of new residential property in Gresham has fluctuated between about $9 million and $20 million annually. Here is the year-to-date valuation for this year. As you can see, 2015 has already eclipsed the previous 5 years in terms of valuation for new residential property, with just over $50 million invested in housing in Gresham. Obviously, that number represents only the valuation to date, which was last measured at the end of August. So we expect the final valuation number for 2015 to be even larger. This looks like great news, right? Well, if you're like me, though, you probably are wondering what the total valuation number looked like in the years before the Great Recession. This slide will illustrate that for us. As we would expect, the numbers were much higher in the pre-recession years, so of course, there's still ground to cover to get those levels of residential development and investment. That being said, our year-to-date number for 2015, 8 months into this year, is about half the valuation added in 2003, which was the highest in the last 20 years. When it comes to economic development speedy review timelines, and aggressively low fees are not the only deciding factors for those looking to bring investment and economic vitality into Gresham. In addition to those elements, we also have to provide a level of livability and vibrancy that merits those investments. On that topic, I want to take just a moment and stress the importance of focusing on and ultimately improving outcomes on our K-12 school system in Gresham. While that is not directly a city service, our education outcomes end up being the determinative of the attractiveness of our community to young families. I certainly know that there are some difficulties in achieving desired educational outcomes when we're dealing with higher levels of poverty and family challenges. But that absolutely cannot be a convenient way to say that we are still ultimately responsible to get those results. The leaders of our school districts are aware of this challenge, but our community, our Chamber of Commerce, and all of us collectively need to be engaging with the system, A, to hold the officials accountable for targeted outcomes, and B, to be ready to help them to give personal time and prudent resources to make those results a reality. Without a leading K-12 educational system, we can have the absolute best business climate in the state, and we still won't achieve the community outcomes we desire. Of course, education extends well beyond K-12, and we are extremely fortunate to have a community college available for tens of thousands of students with over 120 professional and technical programs. Mount Hood Community College is an absolute treasure, and we need to keep it front of mind in our economic development efforts. Of course, it also needs our help and our support, and we would be wise to give it exactly that. When it comes to our children and our families, and being an attractive place for families to come, we need to do everything possible to set the table for positive growth. To that end, we have formed a new Commission on Children and Families, which convened last month to assess the current opportunities and needs of kids and families in our community. Using metrics and national best practices to inform their process, they will present recommendations to the City Council in the summer of 2016 on how the city and our many community partners can address existing needs and improve the lives of so many in our community. Now, public safety is always a key factor in ensuring that we have a livable climate for our families and our businesses. While our resources are limited and our demands for service are increasingly varied and robust, our organization, under the leadership of a united City Council, a great city manager, a fabulous chief of police, continue to creatively innovate to find ways to address public safety concerns efficiently and as cost-effectively as possible. The neighborhood enforcement team became a fast favorite in improving livability in our neighborhoods and eliminating chronic issues. This team has been doing the exact type of street-level chronic nuisance work that our residents greatly value, and the council has been very straightforward in labeling these types of functions as budget priorities in the future. We recently expanded the NET team with two additional positions that are currently being filled, and just last week, we learned that we were awarded another federal COPS grant, which will add two more positions as well. Within months, the NET team will go from 2 members to 6 members, and its tremendous impact in the community will grow with its ranks as well. Given the great demands on our resources, the city has become adept at utilizing grant funding to supplement many of our efforts, especially in public safety. Our East Metro Gang Enforcement Team was renewed during the 2015 legislative session to provide another $2 million over the biennium, which will help us continue critical work in combating gangs. Thank you to Senator Lori Montes Anderson and also Representative Carla Peluso for championing that on behalf of the community. In addition to NET and MGET, we have a number of programs that have been launched in the past couple of years to specifically address youth violence and gang prevention. Including late night basketball, summer kids in the parks, partnership with POIC, the Boys and Girls Club, and the Friends of the Children. Similar to our strategic use of grant opportunities, we're doubling down to nurture the city's relationship with key partners like Multnomah County, with whom we are working more closely than ever to find new resources and opportunities for Gresham. Under Chair Deborah Cafori and Commissioner Diane McKeel's leadership, we are partnering to target the areas of the greatest need in our community with service and amenities. Just last week, for example, we celebrated the opening of 2 new futsal courts at Vance Park on 182nd Avenue in Rockwood. Now, for those of you, well, like myself, I must admit, that aren't familiar with futsal, it is basically a miniaturized version of soccer that is gaining popularity with youth in the region. The project started at the most grassroots level. Have you all heard the story about this park? Yeah. So Ricky Ruiz is a kid that works for us at City Hall as an intern. He's just in his final year at Warner Pacific College. He grew up in Rockwood, and he used to jump the fence over here and play at this dilapidated thing before it looked beautiful like that. And they used to put their, they'd take their backpack and their shirts and whatever, and they'd make goals and they'd make do and they'd play a little futsal or soccer. Well, so he's growing up, he's on a run one day, and he comes by the park and he sees kids doing the same exact thing he was doing. And he said, we can do better than that. And this kid put together this whole team with the Portland Timbers, all of the partners, and built that. This one kid in our community giving back. So it's very, very, yeah. And I share those examples only with you today because while those efforts and improvements may not be any secret to you, we have a lot of work to do in sharing the word about our community and business climate to other innovators, investors, and families in our region. So while we all know and love Gresham's great downtown, our well-established neighborhoods, our beautiful natural areas, community festivals, and traditions like the Teddy Bear Parade we just had last weekend, we know firsthand that the dedication of business in this community to invest, hire locally, and support our local economy. It seems that others in our regions may not yet know about these things. Well, that's a first. It's the restaurateur in me. I need to pick it up right away. But we would wash it, I promise you. We would wash it before you got it. So, too often, one of the most difficult things for any elected official to do is to admit that he or she needs help. But, of course we need help in stimulating the critical mass and human capacity to continue the progress in our community. What is the difference between a vibrant community with optimism and progress and a declining community without a vision? People. People are the difference, and I know that the people in this room are exactly those who are ready and willing to step up and get the word out about what we have going on in East County and also step up to serve in leadership positions in the community, be it the city council, the school board, Rotary, Chamber of Commerce, or leading any of our community events. I'm here today to tell you that we do need your help. Our community and our economy is only as strong as our collective ownership of our outcomes. And together, we are poised to seize that day and continue to make tremendous progress. I mentioned Mount Hood Community College a few moments ago. Well, that didn't happen by accident. When Portland came in and wanted to put Gresham into its community college district, our predecessor said, no thanks, we want to make our own college, and we want to make it for our distinct community. And that is exactly what they did. When Cliff Kohler wanted to build the Kohler Building downtown, and the banks told him he was crazy, he said essentially, fine, I'll do it myself. He did exactly that, and it was the catalyst for the modern redevelopment of what has become one of the finest main streets in all of Oregon. When people told Judy Hahn that Gresham's idea of art was a velour portrait of dogs playing poker, she built her art festival anyway. And it's become one of the foremost events with tens of thousands of people attending from all over the United States. When we had the crazy idea of pulling the community together at that event this summer to break the world chalk art record, the community stepped up in a way I haven't seen in years. We had a blast out there with families, and we shattered that record. Now, I can't tell you how excited I was to see long-standing, deeply ingrained, old-fold Gresham families re-engaging in the community at the event and filling downtown with a positive energy. It was awesome. I could go on and on, nearly table by table in this room, and speak about examples of community members standing up to own, love, and engage in this community. But too often, we sit back and we expect that others will be the ones to fill the gap. The problem is that fewer and fewer are meeting that challenge. So the time has come for our next generation of leaders to step forward with confidence and take those risks. Build those festivals, make those investments, own those schools and their outcomes, and become the new old-fold stewards of our community and our local economy. So that's what's on my heart this morning, and I'm always energized in rooms like this because I know we have what it takes in this room to move this community forward. So I thank you all for the time this morning, and I hope you have a very productive day. It was a pleasure to be with you. Thank you very much.
He thought he was leaving, but this is the time for questions. And we are, he spoke so long, we gave him 7 minutes, and he's a politician, took 14, but we knew he was going to take 14, so we planned on that. This is a love thing. Would you please take this fork? No, not you. Come back here. All right, so this is the time for questions. So we have Jesse and Shelley that are going to come to you on the, with microphones, and we're going to ask Shane some questions that's on your heart, on your mind, in your business. If we don't have a question, I have one. Do I see any questions yet? Oh, there's one. Can you see her, Shelley?
Yep. Thank you. I'm Catherine Ruthruff on the Gresham Borrow School Board. Our Superintendent Jim Schlachter is here today. We're looking for opportunities to collaborate with the city. We're in the process of putting together a bond for 2016, and a lot of that includes community space within our school and our fields. How can we continue with you, and how can you help us pass this bond? Because it's not only critical for our kids, I think it's also critical for the community as well.
Thank you for the question, and I have to tell you that Superintendent Schlachter has met and is in generally, we're in pretty close contact about these. In fact, we met, I think, just about a month ago talking about how we can continue to do this. What happens with West Gresham Grade School? How does that play a part of the bond? Does the city have a role in that? One of the things that we have heard the community say for a long time is we want a community center. Right? We want a community center. We're the fourth largest city in Oregon, 110,000 people. We need our own community center. So as that piques my interest, as we talk about how we may be able to partner together to do that, whether it's at that location or a different location, certainly we need partnership with the school districts, and the city's ready to stand and help with that.
Thank you for the question. Is there another question? Yes.
Hi, Mayor Bemis. You guys have been working on with projects with Port of Portland and other partners too, on projects that deal with prosperity of the people who already live here. Can you give us some information about some of those programs to increase the economic viability of families in this area?
Yeah. Well, I think all of the companies that I mentioned today and the statistics I gave you today all help people in Gresham, right? Because if people live here, they want to work here, they have opportunities to get jobs there. So anytime we can add a job, whether it's one person part-time in a downtown whatever shop, or it's 50 people at a new Subaru facility, or it's 100 people at a new yet-to-come facility, anytime those jobs are available, I think it's a good thing for the community.
Okay, you're off the hook. Thank you. Thank you, Mayor Bemis. Thank you, Shane. If you were in Sacramento or Reno, Minneapolis, Salt Lake City, or Seattle, you might have seen her on TV. She was a TV journalist covering politics, courts, and sports as a reporter and a fill-in anchor. She has worked in the healthcare, public affairs, and marketing roles since 2001, currently in business development as a physician liaison for Adventist Health. She is also enrolled in the master's program for strategic communication through WSU. Do they have a football team? An East County resident, mother of a six-year-old who is a first grader, and you know what being in the first grade is like, or being the mother of first grade and crying when they get on the bus, there's that. And she's the proud wife of Skyler. Please welcome board member and our MC for today, Lori Aoki.
Good Good morning, everyone. It's an honor to be here, and I hope we can keep the interaction going this morning. And on that note, one very important lesson we learned at the Chamber through past experiences with these economic summits is that we didn't allow enough time for questions. So as long as our speakers stay to their allotted time, you will all have enough time to ask questions. Anyway, so there are pieces of paper on your table. I'm sorry we didn't provide things to write with, but you all brought pens, right? So if you have a pen, go ahead and write down your questions, and then when the presenter finishes, we will allow you that time to ask those questions. So this morning, we are pleased that Portland General Electric is the keynote sponsor for the Economic Summit. Speaking of summits, John Maloney knows a little thing about summits. John has been a member of the Mountain Hood Ski Patrol for over 20 years and has held leadership positions with the patrol. It's a passion of his, and so just ask him about it, and he'll tell you all about it. John is an industrial energy specialist for PGE. He's a graduate of OSU, so please don't hold it against me that I'm now a student of WSU. And today he represents PGE. Please welcome my fellow board member, John Maloney.
Good morning, everybody. Appreciate you all being here. And as Lori mentioned, I am John Maloney. I work for PGE. And what I do for PGE is I'm a commercial industrial rep calling on businesses such as yours throughout East County and so forth. But it does give me great pleasure to introduce our guest speaker today. And he's no stranger to East Multnomah County, if you will, in the Gresham area, which means that he has a good handle on our dealings, what challenges and so forth we're faced with on a daily basis. Our guest speaker is John Tapogna. He is the Managing Director and President of ECONorthwest, who provides expertise in economics, finance, and planning to public and private sectors throughout the United States and internationally. John is obviously very highly skilled in regards to quantitative analysis, which I have to admit was not my favorite class at Oregon State University. But somebody always has to fill those voids. John has developed a reputation of conducting thorough interviews, producing concise reports, presentations, and so forth. John has provided economic and budgetary analytical support to national, state, and local governments, which includes the U.S. Senate Finance Committee, and the Oregon State Legislature. Additionally, John was a budget analyst for the U.S. Congressional Budget Office, where he forecasted the nation's welfare spending and estimated cost of key congressional legislation. Oregon, and specifically this region, is delighted and very fortunate to have John's expertise and someone that we can rely upon in our times of need. Obviously, I could mention more of his credentials and go on and on, but I'd just rather simply introduce our guest speaker, once again, John Tapogna, and he's going to talk to us about reaching our potential. So please help me welcome John.
Right. Well, thank you. I have a PowerPoint presentation, but I don't know how the mayor advanced his slides. Did you just wink at people or something? You did. Who did you look at? Over here. Wow, okay. All right. So, well, thank you. Okay, that works too. All right. Top button. Very good. All right. Well, thanks for having me, and I'm gonna look back at the mayor and say that any elected official that can get up and intertwine the terms human capital and traded sector as much as he did into that speech deserves far more than 7 minutes. At ECONorthwest, we'd be delighted to invite you over, and we could listen to you go until noon on those topics. But seriously, that was very well done, and I think the way it ended with the focus on the kids and the K-12 system, that truly is the magic that this community's got to put together, because it is the human capital that is the foundation, the long-run foundation of what's going to make this part of the region click or not, and it's the traded sector that is going to use that capital. Those are going to be players that are going to come in and out. Hopefully they stay for a nice long time, and they leave the place better than they found it. But, you know, 20, 30, 40 years from now, we're going to have different traded sector actors than we've had in the past. And so it is all about building that foundation with the human capital and other assets that you have here to make the best use of it as you can. Just because we've had spent so much time on college football already today, I am a graduate of the University of Oregon, and my freshman year was the 0-0 tie in the Civil War. So we can all tell Joey Harrington, I am not a bandwagon guy. I was there at that game, and I'm still getting over the cold. So, because it rained, it always seemed like it rained at Autzen Stadium in those days. So I have some slides here. I'm going to move first part of the presentation, about a third of the presentation, just sort of talk about some recent trends that we were able to pull together for this part of the region. And then the latter sort of two-thirds of this, talking about six big factors that I see that will shape not only this part of the region, but the Portland metropolitan area as a whole. And you know, it really is a linked endeavor because regions are organic beings that grow together. So let's take a look at where Gresham has been in the recovery. Unfortunately, when you start to splice down the region, the data gets a little bit less reliable and more outdated. So we did the best that we could. But here's a look at what has happened between 2007 and 2013. So 2007 was the sort of the official beginning of the recession, the peak of the last expansion, and where you had changes in jobs. This is sort of Gresham / Greater East County by industrial sector. And the thing that stood out here, a couple of things. First of all, the manufacturing doing better in this part of the region than for the nation as a whole. Nation as a whole, as of that point, was still struggling to regain its manufacturing employment. So at least according to these statistics, Gresham doing better in that regard. The other piece that doesn't match the rest of the region is the slow comeback of the local sector, in particular sort of leisure and hospitality and the like. And I think what's driving that is, unlike sort of downtown Portland, where you had affluent people sort of pouring into restaurants and hotels and whatnot, the local sector in this part of the region is more dependent on regular customers, less tourists, et cetera, and those folks were still working their way out of their bad balance sheets that got them into the recession to begin with, and so a slower recovery in that regard. With respect to, and you know, thank you again for introducing this topic of the traded sector. Traded sector, again, for those of you who don't spend a whole bunch of time listening to the mayor or reading ECONorthwest reports, are essentially those services that are not sold face-to-face within the region. So a traded sector operation would be somebody who's building something, has a specialized operation here, and is selling someplace outside of this region. So manufacturing clearly fits into that. Software development, other kinds of professional business. We have, you know, a growing architectural traded sector in the Portland region, et cetera. Whereas local sector is more face-to-face. So it's going to be the education sector. It's going to be the healthcare sector. It's going to be the utility sector, where you're selling to inside of the region. And you can see that the mix here in Gresham is pretty well in line with the rest of the region, about a little bit more than a third of the jobs being traded sector and two-thirds being local sector. Now, some folks will say that you want all traded sector, and the more traded sector that you can get, the better. Again, I would say that it having a nice, robust traded sector that's sitting on top of a foundation of a well-functioning local sector, good schools, a great healthcare system, great state and local government services that are well-run and efficiently run, is absolutely critical. So and that local sector is something that's going to go on, and those traded sector firms come in and make good use of it and hopefully build up wages and prosperity. In terms of how things have fared for the traded and local sectors in Gresham versus the Portland metropolitan area generally. The dotted lines are the MSA, the darker lines are the Gresham area. Again, you can sort of see the recovery, very quick recovery of the local sector in Portland. That is because as soon as people could afford to eat downtown, they started pouring into the downtown restaurants and back into the Whole Foods and all those kinds of places that they like to go to when they have discretionary income. And so that stuff came back. But you can see the dark blue line for Gresham sort of continued down, and only beginning in 2012, 2013 started to have a bit of a rebound. I'm gonna guess, looking at the mayor's chart from the building permits, because construction is going to be sitting in that local sector and a lot of other activity going on there, that by the time we have data for 2015, you're gonna see a healthy recovery in that space. Again, the traded sector, and this is kind of backwards for most of the charts that I would see for the country, traded sector certainly took its hit in the Gresham area, but didn't fall as far as the local sector did, which is kind of interesting. That's not what you see either nationally or for the Portland metropolitan area. Gresham and middle wage work, an awful lot of talk about job polarization. How many people have heard of the term job polarization? The mayor can use that. You can use that in your next set of... But job polarization is sort of this phenomenon over the course of the last three decades that we've had relatively strong growth at the two extreme ends of low-skill work and high-skill work, and a hollowing out in the middle. And the hollowing out in the middle, this is a national phenomenon, it's a Portland regional phenomenon as well. The hollowing out in the middle has been caused by a couple of phenomena over the course of the last three decades. Some of that middle skill work now being done overseas, manufacturing, production work and the like, and then technology over the course of the last three decades. Any kind of routine work that is sort of a routine step piece of work, be it at, say, a bank teller or what used to be drafters in architectural offices, increasingly parts of grocery clerk work, et cetera. If there's a routine aspect to that work that software can replicate, software will eventually take that job over. And there was a fair amount of that work sort of sitting in the middle. Here's for the metropolitan area, how we characterize the different occupations that are in the high wage and the two middle tiers, and then the low wage area. So the upper middle would be construction, installation, repair, teachers are in that space, protective services, and communication services, lower middle, administrative work, health support, transportation, and sales. So that's when we're talking about those wages and where that middle is with respect to how Gresham is faring here. A larger share of Gresham's work is sitting in that middle space relative to Portland. Across the country, that the share that was in the middle has declined, and worries that it will continue to decline, which is a challenge because it becomes very hard for people to sort of start out in the lower wages and find ways up and out of poverty. So the creation of these middle skill jobs is a real key to economic mobility, and trying to think about how we continue to sort of educate and build skills and opportunity for people in that space is a central public policy question that we have right now. With respect to where these jobs are in the region, this was a map we did for the Portland Business Alliance and the value of jobs work that we do for them. I would characterize this largely as saying middle skill work is generally close to rivers. It is in hospitals, and it's sort of hard to see the hospitals here, but if you know where one is, go look on it on the map, and you'll see that there's a lot of middle-skilled jobs in hospitals. And then along sort of the Highway 26, 217 corridors as well. But you can see that middle-skill work, there's a fair amount of it east of 205, and an awful lot of folks living here who have that sort of high school plus maybe up to an associate's who fit into this, into qualifications for a lot of that kind of work, that middle wage work. And so keeping a focus on that, creating those opportunities is important. So that's sort of where we've been. And now I'm going to sort of briskly go through six. And I guess I sort of have competing incentives here, since you have questions and answers. I could either filibuster through and not have to face. Okay. All right. I'll move through briskly, and I'll save time for questions and answers. Six factors that are going to shape Gresham and the region as a whole. Number one is the decline of work, or the change of work, and this is building off of what I just talked about with what we've been going through over the course of the last 30 years. There are respectable national economists who 20 years ago would have never admitted that we're running into some challenges creating work, but folks like Larry Summers used to be the, you know, head of the Treasury Department and on the Fed, et cetera, is now openly worrying that technology is eating away at labor faster than we can think of things to do. And the most extreme playing out of this is people are worrying that humans may eventually become like the horse. They were very important a century ago, but now we just kind of look at them nicely. So, That's not my theory, but that's what some people worry about. So to the decline of work, some very sharp engineers at Oxford University in England looked at all of the occupations in the United States, and they went through sort of the occupational skill codes and said, where do we see more of this kind of routine work that is susceptible to software taking over? And if we were to sort of look out 10, 20, 30 years, what are the kinds of occupations that are the most at risk of being sort of eaten away by software? And they created a chart that is very hard to look at, especially at about, 8:15 in the morning. So I'm just giving you a heads up. This will give you a bit of a headache at first. But what they did is sort of, they created a distribution of the kind of work that they thought was going to be at most risk, and it looks like this. On the right-hand side are and I couldn't do anything with it because I don't have all their detailed numbers to make it look nicer. But on the right-hand side are occupations that they believe are at the highest risk of computerization. On the left-hand side are those that have the most sort of human elements to them, the most complexity and cognitive needs to them that are the least likely to be computerized. And the ones on the right, you've heard an awful lot about autonomous vehicles, and they are on their way. I wouldn't expect self-driving cars running around Gresham anytime soon in complex urban, because there's a lot of regulatory stuff that has to happen. But I'm going to bet you within the next 5 years you're going to start seeing autonomous semis running between cities on major freeways, because that is not a terribly complicated sort of city to city, and computers don't get tired and they don't, you know, drive off the road and things like that. So you probably have an improvement, a rapid improvement in safety. It may start with somebody sitting in the cab and there for an emergency for a period of time until we begin to trust these things more and more. Office and administrative support. Who here has ever heard of an outfit called, I think it's called Ruby. Based in Portland. And they've sort of created this large traded sector operation where they are serving receptionists and concierge service for small businesses across the United States, and it's software enabled. So in essence, a small business owner can go out and play golf and say, if this person calls, interrupt them, don't let them know I'm on the seventh green or whatever, sort of cover that over. And through that software, they're able to sort of carefully navigate, understand who needs to be forwarded on, who isn't forwarded on, et cetera. And it is eating away at jobs in all those little small businesses across the United States that probably would have paid for somebody to pick up the phone in each one of those offices. You move over to the left-hand side from your perspective, things like healthcare. Certainly there's going to be an awful lot of technology that is complementing and advancing and making more productive the healthcare sector, and there will be some computerization there. But the take from these Oxford engineers is that you are not going to accept a diagnosis from a robot. And that there will always be some kind of human element, by definition, some human element that is that's required in that job. Engineering, design, and science, Nike making, designing shoes and things of that nature, it's much more in here and something that comes from the brain and the heart at the same time and the eyes that's going to be very hard for robots to take over. So that's a piece that it feels like it's moving at an accelerating pace. The jobs that we have today are not necessarily jobs we're going to have tomorrow, and some worries that there's just not going to be enough to go around, and we're going to have to think about how to deal with that. So that was the first point. Number two, and something that I think this region absolutely has to get its mind wrapped around, is the growth of the global middle class. And this is a projection of the shares of middle class consumption that are in different parts of the world. So these all add up to 100% in each one of these years. And if you sort of go back to 2000 on the left-hand side, you can see that the two, the dark blue and the lighter blue, are the combination of the European Union and the United States. That makes up a big fat piece of global middle class consumption. So it's basically saying, where are people that are spending, I think their definition was somewhere between $10 to $80 per person per day, which is kind of light by our definition of a global middle class, but it's a global definition. And where is that headed going forward? And you can see the rise of China, India, Asia, and others as well. All you have to do is, I think it was 2 days ago, there was a piece on Nike sort of spread nationally that their sales in China had increased 30%. And it's, China's struggling, but nobody told Nike. And what they clearly see this. There's a huge demographic across the world that is moving into sneaker buying potential. And they're going to make money as long as they can figure out how to ride that wave. And I would say that Oregon, given our history and our DNA tied to trade, our position on the Pacific Rim, our long-going connections with Asia, is in a perfect position to just think of opportunity after opportunity after opportunity. And that chart should be on sort of every economic developer's and every business person's sort of front table to think about how do you take advantage of this rising global prosperity. This one is three charts, three maps of the United States that I think are going to shape in different ways what's going on in this region. Heat hazards and the second paycheck. So how many people have ever heard of the term the second paycheck? That was popularized by the founder of our company, Ed Whitelaw. He basically said that one of the advantages that Oregon has is that in addition to getting a paycheck from your employer, you also get to look out the window at Mount Hood, and that you're, to some degree, willing to accept lower wages to be able to live in a place that's as appealing, naturally appealing, as the Pacific Northwest. And in fact, since then, economists have actually kind of estimated how much people are willing to pay in that. And so here's the first map on the second paycheck, recently produced by the US Department of Agriculture. where green is are those natural amenities that through sort of stated preferences Americans are sort of striving to be near, and the browner places are places with less. So it's sort of temperate climate. People like to, they don't want too hot, they don't want too cold. They would like a little more sun than we have here, which is why we're not quite as green as Deschutes County. And they like slopes. They like change in topography. And they like access to water. So map all of that, and you can see the challenges that a place like Cleveland has. I went to Cleveland a couple of years ago, and it really is a wonderful community spirit. They've got this tremendous asset base from the past. However, one of their economic development strategies, imagine this, was getting on planes and going to Boston, New York, and Washington, and trying to persuade people, successful people who had grown up in Cleveland, to come home. That is not our problem. We have this natural pool of in-migration that, to some degree, sometimes we think it's too much. We've got too many liberal arts majors that are trying to come here and do things. But that's a very different problem. And I would say this sort of sits underneath. It's an opportunity. Oregon is going to, during economic expansions, is always going to have this sort of magnetism to it, where people want to be part of this. If you ask Cliff Mass is an atmospheric scientist and an expert on Pacific Northwest climate at the University of Washington. I rarely quote people from the University of Washington, but Cliff Mass is an exception because he's very insightful, and he has basically said that his hypothesis is this natural, because of climate change, this natural appeal is going to be reinforced, and he's created this map, which is basically to say, if climate change plays out according to his projections, this is where he sees the world going. The water stress in the southwest, heat waves across the middle of the country, severe storms, and sea level rise along the east coast. His point being, the Pacific Ocean acts as a natural air conditioner in this very idiosyncratic place in the world that we happen to be, and that because we have a rocky coast and not a flat coast like the East Coast, yes, there will be some flooding in Manzanita, but it's not going to go as far inland as it will when the Atlantic Ocean meets up with the Everglades in Florida. So that climate change potential is a reinforcement, and I would say if it continues to play out, our population projections are probably off as more and more climate refugees potentially come here. And then, of course, I couldn't avoid this one, which I was ignoring until that New Yorker article came out. I think looking at this USGS map made me feel a little bit more secure about Portland relative to Seattle. And I was persuaded maybe bolting down the house wasn't okay. I don't actually have to move all the way to North Dakota to get away from this. I think if you really squint at this map, Gresham's in better position than, say, Hillsborough. So you've got that going for you. Number four, and I think this one, obviously, I feel like I'm sort of behind the curve on this one, but boy, every day something is coming out on housing affordability. And you can go back, there was the big book that came out from Thomas Piketty last year on global inequality, and then this kid from economist from Westland, Oregon. He's a graduate from Westland, Oregon. He was at MIT. Basically did a critique of Piketty's book on inequality and said, it all boils down to housing assets. that really what's going on in terms of wealth inequality in the globe is this sort of these constraints on land supply and zoning and all of these things building up real estate wealth for a select number of people that were able to buy it before these big prices went up. And so on and so forth. So we are marching down. This is sort of the index of three different metropolitan areas since the 1980s. The green is the Silicon Valley, the San Jose area. The red at the bottom is Houston, which their name is the City Without Limits. And I went down there just this last February, and there was this panel with home builders and some city councilors, and somebody asked them, this was a Portland audience, there were all these Portland folks that had traveled there, some people from Metro, et cetera, and somebody brought up the word sprawl. And the guy says, you know what, I reject that term sprawl. It has negative connotations. He says, we have an urban growth boundary in Houston. It's the Rocky Mountains. And when we get there, and when we get there, we'll have skiing in Houston, and that will be a good thing. So in any event, you've got two regions, Houston and San Jose, which really sort of build on the same kind of comparative advantage. Both of them are by water. Both of them work with engineers, some of them petroleum engineers, other ones software engineers, et cetera, and they have just simply decided to go with completely different models of how their region wants to expand. Portland's in the middle here, and you can see we're sort of carving this middle space between the two. And I would say because we have this natural in-migration and this appeal to this region, it's somebody's cup of tea, it's enough people's cup of tea that they want to come here and try to be a part of it, that we really do get to determine our future on this. We can either sort of drift toward that green line and make this ever more exclusive, like San Jose has, or you know, you try to bend a little bit toward that red line and make housing more affordable and accommodate more people in the region. It is, I believe, a choice. And I only had six of these, so I'm getting close to the end here, Lynn. The changing role of the federal government. Very simply, I'm an old Congressional Budget Office analyst. I'd say this is becoming an increasingly easy way to characterize the federal government. It is an insurance trust with a standing army. Anything that that isn't Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, or the Defense Department is increasingly going to be squeezed. And you know, from this region's perspective, the challenge there is going to be in transportation funding. We have near-term, immediate federal trust fund issues in front of us, but those don't stop anytime soon. This is the Congressional Budget Office's projection of major healthcare programs, of Social Security, of interest on the debt, and then that dark blue line is the share of GDP that's federal non-interest discretionary spending. So Head Start programs, research and development, things of that nature, all trying to come out of that very slow-growing part of the budget. And then last are the border differences, and I'm sorry to leave, because I'm generally an upbeat guy, and if Portland were a stock, I would buy it, but I will leave you with this border difference piece, which is an odd one. So Ed Glaser, who everybody agrees is this brilliant urban economist out of Harvard, at the local level, leaders must respect the mobility of their populations. They can't set policies expectations that their firms are wealthy. Residents are fixed, it puts a strong brake on the ability of localities to redistribute income. So you take that, and then we have nobody as a featureless plane would have sat down and drawn a big circle around this metropolitan area and said, hey, you know, let's just do an economic experiment and put no sales tax on one side and no income tax on the other, and just let sort of see how people move around. Here is per capita interest dividends in rent in Clark County relative to Tri-County Portland going back to 1969. And you can see the, sort of what the run-up in the stock market in recent years, those have come together. I would say that as long as, and forget about Measure 66 per se that went up to 11, but as long as there's any kind of difference, be it 9 or 9.9 in the income tax rate, that there will be an incentive for high net worth individuals at the time that they're selling a business or at the time that they're selling a stock portfolio to, at the margin, at least sit down with an accountant and figure out whether they can buy a condominium and save a bunch of money by moving over to the other side of the river. And that will continue. The other one that is a border difference, that is, it's big trouble, is the PERS deal here, which, you know, forget about Colorado in the middle, let's focus on Oregon and Washington. And this is a chart that Representative Mark Johnson printed and put on the door of his office in Salem. The point here is focus just on the two red bars. The two red bars are the total liability, forget about the unfunded liability, but just the total liability of the cost of the PERS system and then Washington system. Had we blown the whistle in 2010 and just said, okay, we're stopping these, we're just going to pay our bills as long as people are alive, we're going to pay them out, what kind of liability have we accrued? And what you'll notice here between those two red lines is there's not a lot of difference between the liability that was built up in Oregon relative to the one in Washington, literally the same amount, 50-something billion dollars. The problem is Washington is twice as big of an economy as Oregon. So we built up an accidentally, I'll be as generous as I can, I think it was really a just an exotic accident of money match and guaranteed 8% returns and the like that surprised us but created this unusually expensive liability for us given this, the size of our state. The problem is, you know, Gresham-Barlum School District, school districts across the state and city and counties, et cetera, are going to have to pay elevated payroll rates to fund that. Those are already high now. They're going to go up a couple years from now, and they will continue to step up for about 8 years after that, and they'll stay there for about 10 years after that. Meanwhile, on the other side of the river, school districts and cities and counties, et cetera, don't have to pay that elevated payroll tax. By my estimates, for the schools, that essentially means on the Washington side of the border, at the same level of taxation, they can buy somewhere in the neighborhood of a couple weeks of school that we're taking off the top to pay for this mistake from the past. And that couple weeks goes on for 15 years or more. And that is a huge, huge, huge challenge. So with that, I will just sort of do the takeaways. Number one, the big policy levers, housing affordability. I didn't talk a lot about transportation innovation, but I think that plays into it. How this region thinks about transportation, invests in transportation, eventually, and you might throw something at me when I say it, eventually puts a price on its roads to make them flow, we do kind of get to choose our future. And we can either sort of drift in the direction of San Jose, or we can try to stay away from that gravity. And that will really determine what kind of, do we become this exclusive West Coast high end with lower income people way out on the fringes, or do we have sort of a bigger, more populous and more integrated region. Second one, climate change could increase the relative value of that second paycheck, and I think demographers and forecasters should start to think about what that could mean in their scenarios. Asia's rapidly expanding middle class is a tremendous opportunity for this region, and I think the business community certainly recognizes that. but businesses increasingly have to organize around it. With less work to go around, households are going to become more efficient. I think in the same way that businesses have used technology to become more efficient, households are going to figure out how to live in smaller spaces, how to move around with mixes of Uber and public transportation and things of that nature. And then finally, PERS, unfortunately, is going to leave us, when all is said and done, come 2035, 2040, we're going to look back, and we will have paid some share of this. People are going to sort of wake up and say, wow, I feel like I've been paying kind of comparable taxes or even maybe more than my counterparts over in Clark County, but I just don't feel like I was getting the same kind of services. The ambulances weren't coming as fast, the fire trucks, schools always seemed like they were struggling with class sizes and school years and whenever we felt, et cetera. It's an unfortunate period of time. I think, you know, if somebody were ever to write a story of the history of Oregon, I think it will deserve a couple of pages of treatment because I think it does change. It is a generational mistake of that sort of magnitude. So with that, I guess I can answer questions if I still have time, if I didn't filibuster successfully.
So thank you very much, John. I did see a few hands, so if Jesse and Shelley have their walking shoes on, raise your hand high, and we'll get to you. We have someone here in the front, Jesse. And if you would, please stand up, say your name and the organization you're with. That would be great.
Is it really on?
Yeah.
Okay, so Jane Van Dyke, I work at the Columbia Sioux Watershed Council, but I just am intrigued personally about this housing affordability, because I want to say there's, in my mind, and maybe this is my conservation background, but isn't there why is our solution like go out there? Because, you look at Southern California, mm-hmm. where some of my family live, and people moved out for a cheaper house, but they got longer commutes, more time. And so that, to me, isn't housing affordability. So how do we maybe it's a whole big change of make things more affordable that are also have other, in terms of dollars, that have also other features?
Right. Yeah, so this obviously, we're just, as a nation, but and also a region, really starting to get into this. And Seattle sort of got a 9-month head start on us. The easiest way to explain housing is how much economy are you going to put on how much land? So the more economy you try to put on any amount of, if you fix the land, or if in San Francisco's case, the bay and the ocean have fixed the land for you, and you force more and more economic activity into that fixed space, you're going to increase the price of land. In Portland's case, we have very intentionally and thoughtfully over years, we have intentionally constrained the amount of land that we want to use. So that is one piece, that is one factor that we have to think about as we're thinking about housing affordability. I mean, the other one will be if you don't want to build out more, then you're going to have to build up inside of it. So it really boils down to supply and demand. As we have more people coming into this region, just population flowing into this region, trying to be here, trying to do something, et cetera, if the supply of units doesn't keep up with that demand coming in, you're going to put upward pressure on prices inevitably. And the Economist magazine made last year, going back to these examples, is that the Houston metropolitan area issued more housing permits last year than the entire state of California. And so that is a very intentional, that's sort of where you get to choose your future. To the extent that you're lucky enough to be a place that people are willing to move to, this isn't Cleveland's problem. But it is, it, you know, people are still, I don't want to move to Houston, and it's not my cup of tea, and I probably, most people here, have, by having selected this, aren't Houston people, but there are enough people for whom it is their cup of tea. They're willing to go down there, make a living, et cetera, and Houston is saying, the more the better. We're just, you know, this is the city without limits. We're turning this throttle on four. This is our vision, and we're going to build, you know, do the rock. You know, we'll build the fourth and fifth ring road. We'll keep building ring roads around this thing and different city centers because we want, this is the land of opportunity. This really is the Statue of Liberty. Bring us your tired, your weak, your et cetera. We will accommodate them, and that's our mission. That's our goal. That's our vision, et cetera. Here, I think in this region, listening to the beginning of this presentation, it sounds like a little bit more of the vision in this part of the region. I would say, as the region as a whole, absolutely not. I think this region is split between people who are like, God, I wish it would just kind of stay the way I found it. When I moved here in the early 1990s, I could buzz around on the BAM field and 217, et cetera, without much congestion. I could get to Mount Hood and hike, and it was. I wish it wouldn't grow a whole lot. I wish it would be the place that I found it. And that's just, that is a tension, a tension that Portland has that I don't, that certainly Houston doesn't have, or Tulsa, Oklahoma doesn't have, but it's who we are. And out of that, then we have to have honest conversations with one another about how do we best proceed to match sort of competing interests of people that are living in this region.
Thank you. I thought I saw a few more hands. Oh, here we go.
I have a question. Drake Snodgrass, Drake 70s Landscaping, and a fairly good friend of the Chamber CEO. And I snuck in today, just so you know, but I wanted to see it. Thank you for the presentation. Mm-hmm. Excellent job. So during your whole presentation, I couldn't help keep continuing to go to a problem that I think is big for us in Oregon, to go back to the thought of the border and Washington and the amount of friends and clients and so on who I knew in Portland who have now grown a successful business and sold that business, and with the capital gains tax savings that Washington allows or provides, has paid for their new home in Washington. So to me, the last two subjects you brought up are probably the most vividly problematic in my mind, the PERS, which you were very kind about the accident comment, but also, though more important, the border issue. Mm-hmm. So my question is, we have a lot of wonderful and influential politicians and movers and shakers, and I'd like them to hear what your solution to that problem is. I know it's taxes. I know Vancouver is attractive for a lot of reasons, but the tax mm-hmm. situation is one. So could you comment a solution?
Yeah. Well, you know, with respect to the dynamic, I would say that the strongest evidence is that it's a relatively elite and smaller set, but of very high net worth individuals that are making that choice. It does push Clark County and Klickitat County on the Washington border into the top 1% of counties of capital gains per capita, according to IRS data. So it is real. It's not you're not seeing. It's not like a march of people over the 205 bridge, but it is a sort of an elite set of folks that are that are making this choice. So two ways to go to fix this. One would be to go back up to Bill Gates Sr., who led an initiative up in Washington State to institute an income tax in Washington. And get him interested in running that again, because anything that would shrink the difference between us, so that would be one way to go about it. The other way to go about it would be, I believe Senator Hass has been formulating early drafts of a tax package that would increase some kind of reliance
on a gross receipts tax of some sort, not the size that's coming at, out of the our Oregon initiatives, in exchange for a reduction in income taxes. But anything that reduces that 9.9 to zero difference, again, I wouldn't say it was 66 that caused this, because we had 9 to zero before. It's that incentive has always been there, and people have always, they have acted on it. The bigger is the difference, the bigger, the more people who will act on it.
All right. Well, John, thank you so much. We appreciate you sharing your insights and intellect with us today. It does sound like a tall order, I guess, for this region, but one that hopefully by working together we can overcome. So now we are going to turn things back over to Lynn as we thank John once again.